Certainly, Councilmember Widmer.
Yes.
Wiest. Councilmember Lempres is not, is late. Vice Mayor Lewis.
Yes.
And Mayor DeGolia.
I'm here. Are there any public comments or from anyone who wishes to address an item that is not on tonight's agenda? Okay, seeing none.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. You have the written report before you. During our one-on-one meetings, there were no specific Q&A that were significant. However, there is one part of the city manager's report where I'm asking for a recommendation and feedback from the council. SB 50 is back before the Senate. It will be to the governor by the end of the month. And so the League of California Cities has asked that municipalities opine and send letters in with respect to our position with respect to SB 50. The council hasn't formally taken a position or issued a letter in the past. We provided comments and feedback to the league, but haven't issued a specific letter. So I'm asking for feedback this evening for a letter to be written by staff and the existing subcommittee, which is Vice Mayor Lewis and Councilmember Widmer, and then authorize the mayor to execute.
So let's give the feedback.
I thought that the comments that you identified, we actually spoke about when we met on Tuesday, are very appropriate to call out. And I think that it's important that we identify for the institutional housing. You know, we have college and we have schools that are here, and you know, student housing, I think, is very, very important. You can understand what some of the plight is of some of the students just by driving down El Camino, out from Stanford University, people living in cars, people living in trailers. And so I think that getting credit for that is something, whether it's they have their own apartment buildings or they just have their own, I think that's something very important to benefit from.
I felt that it was an
anti-climate bill because it required the authorized housing, or it allowed the authorized housing to have no parking. And if multi-unit dwellings are built, this Peninsula Clean Energy's internal analysis to authorize, for the board to authorize $15 million to build 3,600 electric vehicle charging stations in San Mateo County, which we have authorized and which Peninsula Clean Energy is going forward to build. Peninsula Clean Energy, the staff was very clear that the only way that you can get people to convert from gas-powered vehicles to EVs is if they can charge those vehicles. And if there is a state bill that authorizes construction of multi-unit dwellings for whatever purpose that have no parking, then their occupants will not have electric vehicles. I don't think that goes to the heart of the issues for Atherton. I think the heart of the issues for Atherton are to protect the single-family residential environment that we have. But it's a very relevant issue with the bill, and it only illustrates that the bill authors haven't fully looked at the impacts that that bill could have. And while I'm sure they believe that people who live near transit stations do not need to purchase automobiles, if you live in a community where the closest grocery store is more than a mile away, everybody who lives in that community is going to purchase a vehicle, no matter whether it's near a transit center or not. So I just think the bill send those out today, but I agree with what was said about the newsletter together. I'll make sure I have an opportunity to have input. So I won't do it.
You're besides
me. Aaron, what are we here? We've changed the requirement letters.
So staff, with council's direction, staff to put together a letter in concert with the subcommittee, and then if the council's okay with authorizing the mayor to execute that letter.
Yes, right. I'm sure I understood that properly. So the subcommittee put together a letter, and then what will the council see again or not?
No, authorizing the mayor to execute needs to go out by the end of the month.
But if you could share it with council members and have it online prior to it coming out.
Yes, but I wouldn't be able to develop a consensus for
reference to a
website and you looked at that map, the map wasn't based on where jobs were, it was based on personal income. So we and south of us are in job-rich environment, and then the job-rich environment starts again in San Carlos, but Redwood City and North Fair Oaks are not job-rich environments. Doesn't make any sense. So the job-rich environment cover ends right at the Atherton border, and then it starts again at the San Carlos. And there's all these businesses that are in Redwood City. And when you go through how that cover is, a job-rich environment is the personal income is more than 200% above poverty. And that's how they determine it. And the senator felt that that was adequate.
Just a comment on the council committee assignments. The modification of the surveyor subcommittee is modified to Councilmember Limbus and Councilmember Brown.
Does anyone on the council have any motion to approve item number 7 calendar, item number 8-14, to modification of the matter?
Second.
All in favor? Moving on to item 15, public
So the first component of this process, as I mentioned, is a request for the council to consider certification of the required environmental documentation. The 2019 general plan update itself is the defined, quote, project under the California Environmental Quality Act, or CEQA. An initial study was prepared to evaluate any potential environmental impacts that the updates to the general plan may have. And the subsequent determination as a result of the conclusions drawn from that initial study concluded that a mitigated negative declaration could be prepared. What that means, that MND, or mitigated negative declaration, is that any impacts that were identified had subsequent associated mitigation measures identified to drop that potential impact to a level of insignificance. I'd like to note that this particular MND, unlike other MNDs or other environmental documents that the council may have most recently considered, is not associated with a specific project level evaluation, such as the development of a new building, etc. This is what's called a program level environmental analysis, and what this does is provides foundation for future development projects in their own specific environmental review to base a foundation upon. And I'll get into that in a moment here. So again, what that means is all of the identified mitigation measures within the MND prepared for the general plan update would be actually implemented through any future development project that may have associated environmental review required as part of its own permitting process. So with all of that background said, the MND prepared for the general plan update did identify impacts to the topics of air quality, cultural resources, hydrology and water quality, noise, and utility and service systems. So the general plan project itself, which is broad and long range in its nature, and it does include amendments to both its background and to some of the goals and policies, those were the topics that were identified as having these potential impacts. A mitigation monitoring and reporting program was also prepared and is also part of the environmental document. We're asking the council to consider certification, and what that we call MMRP is just an excerpt of what all those mitigation measures are in a functional table format that not only identifies what the measure is, but identifies who's responsible for it and what the timing associated would be. And then lastly, as it relates to the CEQA component of the general plan update, the required public review and circulation period was done back in April of 2019, and no comments were received. So moving into the general plan, the amendments to the general plan, yes?
So, you know, are there comments that were on the negative declaration first, or do you want to go through everything?
At the preference of the council, I'm happy to do either.
Well, I've got a couple comments in three areas on the negative declaration. I review the city manager, just want to bring to your attention and see what your thoughts are.
Okay.
G side, that it's very clear that emergency access might be impacted. And so again, having it as a none didn't seem appropriate to me. It should be up one level or possibly two from where it is.
So my general response to all of the comments in those three different topics, and Mona, please correct me if I am misstating any of the environmental modalities in changing the document from a identified impact currently known as no impact to less than significant impact. I believe we can do as an addendum to the existing document without the need to recirculate the document. However, the change specifically noted that it was requested was noted in the noise, if I heard you correctly, subsection item D, which relates to the increase in ambient noise levels, which is currently identified as a less than significant impact, to reevaluate that, which we certainly can do, for potential increase in impact to less than significant with mitigation. That's more of a substantive change, and I believe could back to discussion on the general plan itself and the amendments that were made, beginning with the land use element. So what a land use element is, it identifies the type, intensity, and location of uses in private land. So within the town, there are three land uses. There are land uses of single family, which is everything you see there in yellow. There are land uses of schools, which you see in blue, and open spaces, which you see in green. None of that has changed since the general plan, existing general plan was adopted in 2002. So what the land use element doesn't do is discourage or promote any specific type of development, but it rather describes in the way that how that development should occur. And what the land use element also does is maintain the community's overall general vision, as I mentioned before, to maintain its low density, single family residential character by keeping the land uses as they're currently designated. And as mentioned, the draft land use element that you see before you tonight does include the revisions as directed at the November Council study session, and those are specified in the staff report. Okay. Moving into the noise element and what a noise element is. A noise element is intended to also limit, as we were just discussing preliminarily, the exposure of the community to excessive noise levels in noise-sensitive areas and at noise-sensitive times of day. Those are identified within the draft noise element. It also includes diagrams that are forecasted by the acoustical engineers that the town retains services for to help prepare the noise element, or consistency with the guidelines as prepared by the state of California as to what a noise element needs to contain, that modeled what the existing noise levels are within town and what the future noise levels would be. It describes the local condition of the town and it offers some solutions to local noise issues. Couple changes that were made post the November study session within the noise element. Specifically within table N1 of the noise element, which is a comparative table that provides example noise levels of different sources that may be heard throughout the town. That table was simplified. It is now sourced as to where each of those noise examples came from. And it also now has a line item that includes both electric trains and gas and electric leaf blowers. The other revisions that were made have to do with table N2. And table N2 within the noise element is the land use compatibility table for community environments. This is a required component of a noise element according to state guidelines. So I would direct you to that particular table, which is page 97 of 142 within the document. At the November Council study session, there was direction given to staff to reduce the acceptable noise levels at the conditionally acceptable range for residential uses. That change was made. It was previously at a 70 decibel, and there was direction received from the council to reduce that. That has been reduced to 65. On the same topic, but unrelated to the direction received by the council, I noticed that there are other changes that were made to that table that are editorial errors that I wanted to highlight verbally now at the meeting. The intent was not to change the normally acceptable level. That was to remain the same at 55 dBA. The conditionally acceptable, the next range down, keep the baseline of 55 as was previously presented to the council, but again change the acceptable higher end of that to reduce it down from 70 to 65. Moving into the next range of acceptability, the what we call the normally unacceptable range, again keeping that at 65 to 75, that is consistent with the town's existing municipal code noise ordinance as well. And the unacceptable range to also stay at greater than 75 dBA. Moving on to the open space and conservation element, this element identifies areas within a community that provide value both in an undeveloped condition but also as usable open space. It further provides for policies and guidelines that identify how to conserve, how to use, how to develop those particular areas. It attempts to also balance a community's needs with environmental preservation and the effects of climate change through different established policies on how best to consider those identified lands. Again, it has open spaces identified for parks and other active recreation uses as well as schools. So the open space and conservation element before you tonight does include revisions as directed at your November study session and a summarized in the staff report. The community safety element is intended to reduce potential short and long-term risks to a community, both by natural and man-made hazards, such as fires, floods, droughts, climate change, etc. It also needs to identify other hazards relative to safety issues within a community, emergency response, hazardous materials, climate risk, crime reduction. The community safety diagram that is prepared as part of that element has been updated to include identifying emergency routes in consultation with both the police department and Menlo Park Fire District. And then again, as with the other elements, this does include the revisions as summarized in the staff report that were discussed at the November study session. So the circulation element, this is the transportation plan component of the general plan. It identifies both a strategy and location maps that identify infrastructure needs for all means of transportation and circulation. That includes automobiles, bicycles, pedestrians, and other modes. As we've discussed in some of the prior meetings, one of the biggest changes to this element is that it now includes a new level of service standard table. And the intent of that table is primarily for the ability for the town to have some baseline criteria to evaluate future environmental documents and their transportation impacts that they may have on the town by setting what the town's expected level of service standards are. These diagrams have also been updated since the November meeting to make sure that they are consistent with the adopted bicycle and pedestrian master plan. The diagram has two errors that I noticed that will need to be changed. It notes existing class bikeways both on Stockbridge and Oak Grove, and that line should be proposed. This last slide is for conversation. If the council chooses, at your November hearing, there was some discussion on the evaluation of potentially adding three additional streets into the town's street classification table within the circulation element, specifically Laurel, Selby, and Stockbridge. These three streets are currently designated as local streets. They continue to be proposed to be designated as local streets in this draft. But based on the discussion at the council meeting back in November, staff has prepared some additional information should you want to consider changing those streets to collector streets. So I've given you summary traffic volumes for each of those streets, identified proposed bikeways, and what all of that data may mean should you choose to revise the classification of one or any of those three streets. That's it. The biggest impact, or one of the biggest impacts, could be the roadway widths that could be considered. There's identified design standards for a local versus a collector street. A collector street has wider roadway widths and other associated improvements with it. So that could certainly be an impact. Yes, they have them in here. Could they qualify for that?
So I think that at the last meeting, when Councilmember Wittenberg brought up, for example, Laurel, that street has already got the pavement width that's described, includes the bike lane already. So the real difference in terms of the roadway width designation for a local versus a collector is a paved width that's wide enough to accommodate a bike lane as opposed to Sharon's. And so that's the real differentiating factor in terms of the pavement width that I recommended for the different classifications. So if, the traffic level is what it is, they all classify. The amount of traffic on each of those streets is high enough to be considered a collector. It's a matter of what the council desires in terms of really ultimate improvement. And so, for example, if the desire is to have bike lanes on Stockbridge, then classifying it as a collector would enable that to happen. No, the pavement would have to be widened to do it. It's not something that would happen overnight. It's already paved to that width, and it has the bike lane on it already.
Selby is not.
I think that just the lower portion of Selby next to El Camino has that width there. It is a school route. I think that in the traffic study that was done, the recommendation was that Selby be termed a school, local school. Local school, so that it would. The recommendation on the local school was that ultimately it have a walkway to facilitate pedestrian mobility to the schools.
You mean a sidewalk? A walkway?
Walkway.
The current proposed general plan doesn't change any of those three streets from local to public. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Just on the focus for a minute, I was just adding. One of the things that rather than define a collector street there, anybody that passed was with the road and all that, we should remember that we are also going through another process for a townwide traffic review that may end up with a policy, and that policy may very much depend on whether something's designated a local street or a collector street. In terms of, and I don't know where we're going to go, so I don't want to anticipate an answer, but it's quite possible. Just, I want to, let's be aware, it's not just the street, it may have other consequences.
does leave us consistent with what the existing designation is, as well as consistency with the existing draft of the current townwide traffic study.
Okay. I do have a little bit of some concern, like Bill does, on the comment related to the transportation traffic component and the no impact component, because we have heard a few times related to the congestion in the Middle Park Fire District on emergency response trucks and so on and so forth. And so if that issue of no impact is a move to less than significant impact, how does that impact us in this, right? I think that's something that's a minor issue.
So in the initial study mitigated negative declaration, and I believe you're referencing item D, which the question is substantially increase hazards due to a design feature or incompatible uses, and E, which is result in inadequate emergency access, is that correct? Okay. So the no impact conclusion was drawn as a result of what the project is, which is the update to the general plan, and the updates from the existing general plan to the new policies and background documentation that has been prepared as part of this process. So it's not evaluating the specificities that the council members have mentioned, but this project as it relates to those questions. And so that was the basis of the no impact, that the project itself is not resulting in any design features, or neither does it discourage incompatible uses to exacerbate an existing condition that, the council is describing.
If hypothetically, say, Redwood City approved 5 million square feet of retail and right on our courtyard border and Menlo Park did the same thing, we'd look at that and say, boy, traffic's going to get probably worse.
Presumably, yes.
Would we still have it? Would we still have zero answer here? And no impact answer here?
Well, that would be our response to their.
With regard to this document,
With regard to this document, we wouldn't be looking at answering that question in the context of this document. We would be looking at responding to their answer to this question in the context of their project, if that makes sense.
Let me ask it. Correct me if I'm wrong, but just hearing the conversation, we're not, the initial study mitigated negative declaration issue is looking for whether there's mitigation that we need as a result of adopting this general plan. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, so it's not really assessing the impacts of various things in our community, like surf air flights or increased traffic on El Camino. It's assessing whether adopting this general plan, that process, that activity of adoption, creates an impact. Is that, am I right?
That's correct.
Okay. So the real issue is not assessing what's going on, like with the fire district's concern, because the fire district concerns, not just on El Camino, but on March, and we've had plenty of conversation on the council about what's going on each of those streets. But this is in the process of, is adopting what we have in this general plan requiring some kind of a negative impact.
Correct. And I just one point I would like to illustrate. Stepping out of the initial study mitigated negative declaration and into the draft 2019 general plan, in response to those observations and known facts, the general plan, this current draft, unlike the existing, now has enhanced policies, objectives, and actions that do specifically address the observations that some of the council members are noting. So that should a project come in, now the general plan itself as a policy document addresses or attempts to address some of those concerns and identified issues.
Specifically about levels of service.
Levels of service. and other supporting documentation, if the town were to be evaluating outside agencies' development and what those impacts may mean to the town, it'll help strengthen any comments that the town may have on their own prepared development projects.
So, can I posit a question? So if we had changed our general plan to say if we're going to rezone Holger Palmer Park and make it a apartment complex, or something, that would create some of these issues in our environmental.
Definitely. Intensification of land use would heighten the evaluation.
So,
yes.
So we're not doing that.
Correct.
So, and I know it's been an awful lot of work in the iterative process.
Stephanie, is there any consequence for us choosing the less than significant impact versus no impact?
No.
16 is a discussion and feedback regarding a proposal that we have received from Caltrain regarding the closure of the Atherton station. As you all know, Caltrain discontinued weekday service back in August of 2005. Initially, there was shuttle service provided to alternate stations. That was discontinued. The train station continues as a weekend-only station with a holdout. Caltrain has previously committed to restore weekday service with the implementation of their CalMod electrification project. That is outlined in their EIR, as well as in the development of their 2040 business plan. They show restoration of weekday service pretty much on an hourly basis and taking that stop from Menlo Park Station to serve. So Menlo Park would be three trains an hour, we would have one, and that's kind of the level of service that they have shown in the 2040 business plan. Previously, the current town's rail policy includes restoration of weekday service. The rail committee has previously opined on that restoration, and following their recommendation, there was a council and rail committee joint session that discussed the desire to maintain or to reinstate weekday service with future improvements in the system. Since that time, the council created a council subcommittee to meet with Caltrain to talk about what that level of service would be, because initially Caltrain had left it as to be determined. And so there really isn't clarity on, there wasn't clarity on what that level of service would be. Following some discussion, there's been a this proposal that we have. So currently, the level of service is weekend only. As I said, it's on a 90-minute interval, and in the business plan, it's daily service with hourly intervals. So Caltrain is proposing to close the station. What that would include would be removal of the center platform and the access crossings, which are currently there, fencing off the track area, and providing some resources for enhancing the area. As you know, the station is directly adjacent to the town center, town's town center project, which is currently under construction. And it could provide an opportunity for it better integrating the station area into the town center. So funds for landscape screening, station building enhancements, and safety improvements at the walk-through. There are a variety of benefits listed. Obviously, with the closure of the station and not having trains slow down through the station area, there'd be reduced travel times. It's forecasted that ridership could increase by as much as 300 to 500 passengers daily with that reduced travel time. There'd be some reduction in operating costs, as well as capital costs associated with upgrading the station to remove the holdout rule. So that the mitigation that they're proposing, just a little clarity, so use of the property, I mean, we have been utilizing some of their property for parking previously as part of the town center. And so we would have, with the fence that would be installed, we would have potentially more control over the area outside the fence. Again, that could be looked at for integration to the town center project. We'd have control over the parking and have it tied in for the use of the town center. And then also, there's a potential for repurposing the station building. At the discretion of the council. And so here's just an image of just above it is the Caltrain property, and you have the tracks there, the station building outline. Technical support, please.
That's pilot error for sure.
That was me.
On the lease that's in the letter here, are we leasing the property? The use of the offering space now, or are we leasing it?
There is a use.
Yeah, so under this proposal, if we entered into a lease, we would have greater control. So right now, it's their property. They manage it. They maintain it. If they were to lease that property to us as part of that agreement, it would move that control and use over to us and maintenance responsibility as well.
But there was no discussion on what the lease
would be. No, this is a proposal, and we're definitely looking for direction and feedback on how you want to address this proposal, and I'll get into that in just a little bit. So,
one additional question that's in that letter, about a few others, but there was the thing about there are no plans for grade separation, so there are no current plans. And maybe in the future, from other council members, new council members, or that's why not that again.
It's my understanding at this point in time, through the town of Atherton, we are currently at grade, and there has been no formal proposal to change that.
All right, great.
Okay. And so, to do any questions?
You said that there's the county's commitment to restore weekend service, and it's reflected in weekday service. Like the EIR and the business plan. I've heard rumblings about, and I see people in the audience who may know more, but rumblings about representations have been made about restoring that service. Is there anything else to your knowledge? Just those two?
No, I mean, there's been dialogue and agreement in the past about it, and I'm just saying that there are formal documents that Caltrain has basically adopted that show restoration service consistent with. So illustrative of what those improvements might be, so here's an image of the train tracks to the station. You have the center platform and the crossings that would be removed. Again, an image of the station area. There's a red line that kind of shows where potentially the fencing could be, and so it would be about halfway through area, and sorry, it's not very, very large of an image. And then funding for the station building modifications and upgrades, and then funding for safety improvements at Watkins. The one on the right is an illustrative fence that they have elsewhere. It's a decorative wrought iron fence. Yes.
In the letter, it talks about removing the pedestrian crossings for access to the station platform. But would there still be a way to cross the tracks if you're on Fair Oaks, if you're riding a bike or walking?
Fair Oaks itself would remain. And so you have Fair Oaks, you have the pedestrian crossing gates.
Okay.
And so the intersection of Fair Oaks would remain the same.
Mm-hmm.
The platform crossings that I'm referring to are the little pieces of asphalt things that are potential is potential for partnering for access improvements to the Menlo Park Station, investigating whether or not we can put in a crossing at the end of Station Lane over the channel through PUC easement into Menlo Park. That would require a partnership with Menlo Park and agreement with the SFPUC. And so that would, we would partner, if that were something that we would move forward with, we'd partner for looking for funding for that. And so the idea would be, with the closure of our station, providing an avenue, an easier avenue for folks to get to an alternate station.
So, why wouldn't we just have Caltrain partner with commute.org to provide shuttle service during peak times and weekend, specific weekend times that we can model? Because it's about a mile walking to a train station. And in the inclement weather, it's not going to be very pleasant to walk. So it would make more sense, unless there were discussion about potentially having a shuttle service that would go to the Menlo Park station that would pick up and get people to that station in time to meet the train, but wouldn't be going back and forth all the time and just be picking up the time when the express train's going up.
That was not part of the discussion. Let me finish the presentation, and I'll go into kind of some next steps that the council can provide feedback and direction.
Do you miss the usual?
No. And then the other item with improvements, both in the station area and safety improvements at Watkins, is potential for coordination on the potential extension of the quiet zone. So, in terms of funding, Caltrain is looking at an aggregate amount of between $7 and $9 million towards improvements within the town, and it is kind of broken down. Looking at safety improvements at Watkins, it could be up to about $5 million. Platform and crossing removal of about $750,000. Fencing, landscaping, about $2 million, and then almost $1.2 million for funding of station building. So that's kind of where the numbers came from.
Whose numbers are those?
These are from the country.
So $5 million is the quantities?
Potentially, that's that's the... That's
on
the
third one?
Well, there's more than the quantities.
Yeah. So,
that's my question. Is there more than 5 feet? Do you have 5 minutes?
I think that it's studies and improvements related to implementing the safety improvements there, I guess.
The safety improvements there are 5 minutes?
That, and there's probably going to be some modification to the pedestrian crossing.
Yeah.
So, it's really at the pleasure of the council as to how they would like to have us respond. We're bringing this proposal to you for feedback. And so the council can choose to provide feedback for us to either go back to the rail committee for feedback, keep it at the council level. That's at your discretion. There are quite a number of folks in the audience that are here to provide feedback tonight.
And what is sort of the timing?
The timing, we would like to be able to have process of that enclosure, if the direction is to provide them with an alternate proposal, that is certainly at your discretion.
All right.
So, I'm going to open it up for public comment. Do we have people fill out forms or?
No, but if you could stop at the desk back here and I'll get your name. And then you can go ahead to the mic.
If for anyone who wants to make public comment, if you would just let Anthony know that you want to make public comment, and you could do that by standing up, then he will organize it, and we ask you to please keep your comments to less than 3 minutes. State your name and where you're from.
I don't yet, so it's...
Stood up so you can see who wants to share.
Okay.
Anthony, why don't you go ahead and shoot their names, and then that way you can just call them up sequentially.
Yeah, that would be helpful if you want me to go around, or would you guys like to come back here? Don't move, let me.
Okay. Well, Honorable Mayor and members of the council, Malcolm Dudley is... I hope that you've all received the letter that I sent last night.
Regis, R-E-G-I-S.
Obviously, I've been very involved with the issue, not just for this town, but for the...
Okay.
Anderson.
I think one thing we can all agree upon is one of the major problems we face here, is traffic congestion.
Anderson.
It's a serious problem, and it has been. When we first moved to Atherton 50 years ago, I recall when Whipple Avenue was a two-lane road, and it became congested as two lanes. They had it widened into the four, and it became congested as the six lanes, and it's congested with that. Woodside Road, there was a proposal that actually plans for a double decade Woodside Road. That was when Costco was built. In Palo Alto, they, of course, created the Oregon Expressway. And in Menlo Park, they were going to make it as Highway 84. And that was resisted by the community. It's a serious problem for a lot of reasons. Safety, health, quality of life. In Atherton, we face the prospects always of, we did, pressure to widen our roads, whether it's Marsh Road, Middlefield Road, or Atherton Avenue, Alameda, to deal with the increasing traffic. It's a serious problem. We live in Linwood, getting out of the gates at times of the day is very, very difficult. And so the idea of closing alternatives to the automobile make no sense at all. Atherton has a lot at stake here. We contribute, the taxpayers of Atherton, through their sales tax, about a little over $500,000 every year. With Measure A, that was a 20-year plan, we contribute about $9 million. So our investment is very large in being served by rail. And, we've been big supporters of Caltrain when the Measure A was put before us. They had an expenditure plan. They don't want people to have to vote on a blank check. They wanted to identify the projects that would be funded. And
changed dramatically. I can't imagine cutting down on the alternative automobile if indeed that were to happen. Then I think we have to look at how we do provide the kind of service that we really need here in town. And if you look at the history, we were the very first stop in the state of California for rail service, the drop station, 1867, 153 years ago. That's 50 years before we even became a city. And I do know that there have been some people on the staff for Caltrain that have really been interested in limiting the service to Atherton for a long time. And it didn't happen initially, so the first step was taken, and that was to eliminate our peak service. Now they talk about two of the problems. One is ridership. Well, if you knock out peak service, clearly you're going to reduce your ridership, and that was intentional, obviously. That's one of the factors. Another is they
what
talk
is your recommendation to us?
Okay.
You're past
3 minutes. Oh, am I? Sorry. All right. That's why I wrote the letter, because I did it. Well, my recommendation is that what we do is, as we've in the past requested, we restore our weekday service, get back to provide the kind of service that we really need as a community. And we have a huge investment in this. And if we don't, I'm just going to add one other thing. You'll know in the letter I indicated there that if indeed this is the approach that Caltrain takes, is adverse to the communities they're serving, we need to look at alternatives, and there are alternatives. And I laid out one where you consolidate the Capitol Corridor and BART and Caltrain into one. There'd be huge savings of money with them. There would be a restoration of service based on my conversations we've had. I'd rather not go that way, but if indeed we're facing elimination of service, I think we need to look at that. And it's not just mine, it's not my idea. Brent Copley was chair of the Senate Transportation. That was his proposal, was to consolidate. Of course, each agency has it, wants to protect its own turf, and that didn't go forward. But I think that we need to restore. We have to have alternatives for health reasons, for safety reasons. So I urge the council to go forward with our original plans, and that was to restore the kind of service that we really needed. Thank you.
So next we have Roland LeBrun, and what I'll do is when you have 1 minute left, I'll give you kind of a 1 minute warning. It's at the pleasure of the mayor.
There are some people that are infirm. I'd like to give them preference.
Sir?
Because I don't know how long they can stay here.
Okay.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Roland LeBrun. I'm from San Jose. I want to achieve three things in less than 2 minutes. Is to give you clarification as to what prompted this letter on January the 8th, issues with the letter, and then suggestions moving forward. The reason you received that letter on the 8th is that at the MTC programming allocations on January the 8th, item 4A, was an item for removal of two hold-down route stations and rebuilding stations, always stalling mitigating connectivity and improvement projects in exchange for the closure. The ask was for $25 million per station, not 30. So altogether, it's $50 million. They got half forgot that this afternoon I stopped at a station called College Park in San Jose, or Bellarmine School, which is a program station. So Mr. Hartnett is going to have some announcing to do here. Now, right, so I've already done all this. Now, they're asking you not to have great separations at Fair Oak and Watkins. But you know what? They're just coming up with this excuse to have two great separations in downtown Redwood City. And the way they're going to get them is by saying, oh, we want four tracks. Why? Because you've got four tracks, you get automatic great separation, and somebody has space for it. Okay? That's not in the letter. Oh, and by the way, in case you forgot, Mr. Hartnett used to be mayor of Redwood City, but that's neither here nor there. Now, so, in closing, my recommendation to you is to ask Caltrain to consider building a full-blown six-track station at Redwood Junction, which basically will be 1 mile north of where the existing station is. If you do this, you're going to have high-speed, I mean really fast connections to San Francisco, to Silicon Valley, and to the East Bay. There will not be any need to take Dumbarton Rail to downtown Redwood City, which is absolute nonsense as far as I'm concerned. This is just pure bundle. Now, and that basically is it. That's my recommendation to you, is to build a mega station 1 mile up from where you are right now. Thank you.
Next we have Narissa Dexter. Next, we have Regis Anderson.
My name is Regis Anderson. I live on McCormick Lane. I've been there 25 years. I would encourage you to close the Atherton station. The noise is incredible along our area, and I would welcome the fact that they could enforce the whistle blowing to vacate it. Thank you.
Next, we have Frank Burke.
Good evening, council members. My name is Frank Burke, and I'm a resident of Lloyden Park. I support the closure of the Atherton station. I am an actual Caltrain rider, slash BART rider. and I regularly ride rail to downtown San Francisco, Oakland, and San Jose. And as we look to the future, I believe more and more people choose that method because that last mile getting into San Francisco or getting over the bridges to get to Oakland is intolerable. Once that Google thing goes in by Diderot, you're not going to be able to get off of the 87, off of the 101. So getting local service into Atherton at the cost of even one limited train out of Redwood City or Menlo. I always go Redwood City north, Menlo Park south. It's very good. I think that once a person has ridden on a limited train or a baby bullet, they would never go back to a local train because the time difference is immense. It's almost twice as long than a local train. I honestly believe that for most people, I don't know if they're called Athertonians or not, but most residents of Atherton, Redwood City and Menlo are equally accessible to the Atherton station because for most people in this town, they can't walk to the Atherton station. You have to be dropped off somehow. So there's automatically a car ride. And Menlo's only 1 mile south. I don't know exactly how far downtown Redwood City is. It's slightly more than Uber anyway because the fare is slightly more. But I think that people would find it immeasurably better to have more frequent limited service and baby bullet service to go to these congested places where people would tend to be wanting to be going than any local train service coming through Atherton. I applaud if the subcommittee negotiated or had a part in negotiating all these wonderful things that will happen with the increased town center area, which I think will be very nice, make it a real gathering place. The safety improvements are huge. And as a person who has been a beneficiary of the quiet zone north of Fair Oaks, your ability to have quietness, because they have to blow the horns now as they go to the station, they can't, once that's not a station, they will not be blowing their horns right in front of our new town center. The difference between having those horns blow all the time and not is immense. Our peace of mind is doubled or tripled, and you will find it be a much more pleasant town center to not have trains blowing their horns in our station. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next we have Barrett Anderson.
I'm Barrett Anderson, I'm related to Regis Anderson. We both live on McCormick Lane, one block from the little train station and a few hundred feet from the tracks. Just the noise of the train horns would say we're willing to give up that cute little station building. It ain't the Saint, it ain't Westminster Cathedral. We like it. It's cute, but it's time to move on. In our quarter century of living here, we have some lovely memories of this town, and we don't want to see it change, but this is one change that wouldn't hurt. We've ridden the train both directions, but in the future, we welcome the much faster express service that we'll get from the two nearby stations at Menlo and Redwood City, get to San Francisco in half the time in exchange for driving 3 or 4 minutes to one of those stations. In fact, if you live off of Valparaiso, you're just as close to Menlo Park as you are to the existing Atherton station. Well, we urge the town council not to let and Caltrain to work together and not let this remarkable opportunity go by and work out the details to make it come true. I'm very impressed with the proposal that they've made. And the elephant in the room that we haven't talked about is SB 50. And that is another factor that goes on one side, and I'll let you decide which side. Thank you.
Next we have Alex Key.
Hi, Council. I'm in favor of closing the station, and I think one of the great benefits we'll get out of it is the safety improvements and quad gates at Watkins. I think that's one of the great things. And also, as I'm a member of a friend of the library, and I know the library is going to benefit greatly from much fewer frequency of, no horn once we get especially through the train, through the train station we'll get it, but then also if you can extend it as well. Thank you.
Next we have Jim Massey.
I understand that would be brief. I support closing the station as soon as possible and buying into Caltrain's plan, integrating that old, lovely station into the new city center with the additional parking, making it a nice, complete thing for Atherton. Close it. Thank you.
Next we have Randy Hodnett.
I live in Logan Park, and I'm in favor of closing the station for all the reasons everybody else before me has mentioned. The Caltrain letter to the town mentions exploring the feasibility of a new path next to the Caltrain right-of-way south of Watkins. This strikes me as spending a lot of effort and money for possibly little benefit. I've walked to and from downtown Menlo Park a few times when my car's been in the shop, and I just stay on the east side of El Camino Real south of Watkins. It's certainly not ideal, but despite the heavy traffic, I found it easy to keep well away from the vehicles on the road, even in the stretches that have no sidewalks. If the pathway next to the Caltrain right-of-way existed, I don't know that I'd use it. Walking for a mile alongside the railroad with the occasional train zooming by doesn't seem much better to me than walking along El Camino. So, of course, other people might disagree. But all I'm saying is that the town shouldn't automatically assume that the pathway would be worth the non-trivial effort and money it would take to make it happen. Thanks.
Next we have Matt Chen.
Hey, council members. I just want to speak just to basically suggest that you guys generous proposal. As a proud father recently of three, I have a girl who's four, and I have two twin boys that are now 2 months old. Just imagine walking along in that new civic center to the library, possibly the Little League, across Watkins. I think the safety improvements make a lot of sense there. I also wanted to talk about one other angle that I don't know if anybody's touched upon, but we talked a little bit about traffic congestion, some traffic going through Atherton. Fair Oaks is a collector at Collector Street. It's one of the main streets that people use to get from Middlefield to El Camino. The gate town time during according to the upcoming Caltrain plan will be significant, and to remove the station would actually improve that. And let's keep in mind that the Civic Center is right next to that, where we have our police station. Recently, with the burglaries, people are concerned about response times. So those are things to think about, getting the cars out and to the other side of Atherton. We've got fire vehicles going across that. In addition to, also we have Samtrans that runs Route 84 on that same Collector Street. So I think it's also important to think about the gate down time on Collector Street.
Next we have Mr. Greg Conlon.
That's not a suggestion, that's a fixed commitment. Because without that, then you're really finding a pig in a poke. Is that firm? That $5 million, that's floodgates?
That's my understanding.
Because without that, I mean, you get the quiet zone only with the floodgates. And I just want to make sure that you're not, they're not specific on those slides, so I want to make sure. And the second thing is I want to say is I think it's a temporary fix no matter what you do. 10 years from now, you'll have four high-speed trains going through this station at 110 miles an hour. And every train that you, once you get the quad gates up. So you're going to have to do something again. So I think you need to look at the grade crossing and get the trench idea developed with Menlo and Palo Alto. Because it's just temporary. When you get those four high-speed trains going through here every hour, and probably the local trains will be up close to 100 miles an hour. It's going to be like a zoo. You're going to hear those things zip through here. You're going to think it's noisy now. Wait till you see those four high-speed trains go through here. So I'm just saying that don't think this is going to solve the problem. You've got a grade crossing problem that needs to be addressed. And I think a trench is ideal. A tunnel's ideal, but it's too expensive. But a trench is ideal from a practical standpoint. And I think Palo Alto is backing into it by eliminating, you know, if you've tried everything else, you'll wind up with the trench because you can't, there's nothing else to do. So I'll leave you with that thought and wish you luck.
And lastly, James Bradbury. That was the last person that I had.
Does anybody else wish to make a public comment on this important issue?
Can I just make a comment, tagging on to what he was saying about the pathway? My kids have aged out of school now, but that would be another option for these kids not to have to go down Middlefield to get an MA or to maybe cut through Holbrook and jump the fence, right? They take the pathway down to Encinal and go across. It's just a thought, right? As
perspective of a belief in public transportation, and I do believe in that public transportation, many cars so we can get off the road, the better. But it seems that if you believe in that concept, you have to believe that Redwood City and Menlo Park are better partners in making this system better. Because it will also keep the limitations of a two-track minimum. I can't say what will happen in the future, but we really don't want to hear a four-track impacts to the town with a four-track component. It would be astronomical. So why not, in the perspective of talking about a station and giving up that right, allowing Caltrain to, if, you know, have more of an opportunity to continue to function within a two-track minimum, therefore not have to consider those potential upgrades, which would be substantial to get down, and not just the fact that we have a station. So I'm very passionate about it. I'm very passionate about the fact we're trying to make the residents safe that may potentially be at the station, our residents of the communities in our higher density area, the Lloyd Park people and so on.
could see this again, no matter what we do, we can always do that, is developing these practices. There'll be a memorandum of understanding will be developed, so it'll send them back to us. So we'll have a chance to see this again, hopefully with more specifics in it, because it's still, there's a lot of things to be filled in. I think it's, on the whole, let me start at the end. My conclusion, on the whole, I think it's a good idea to take both the country and close the station to get the benefits we can get. But, and it's pretty good, we're going to have quite a lot when we go to the station. Nottoms has been around since 1867. It's a big deal. And once we do this, it's permanent. We're not going to get it back. So, from my standpoint, I want to make sure that we really understand what we're getting. And so, I think we need to make sure this MOU is detailed when it comes back to us, especially what we're doing. I also would love to see, by that I mean fun things about, yes, quad gates are going to be funded no matter what, how much it costs, you know, what you're going to expect. I also would love to see more about noise mitigation. I don't know exactly what's involved, but we can. I'd like to learn more about that, how it would affect the new town center. On the whole, for a lot of reasons other people said, including the fact that it would be very difficult to maintain that station in the future as the number of trains are increasing. It'd be a real challenge for us to do a good job with that station. I think it makes sense to close it. I think it's better for the system. I think it's better for the rail system and commuters generally. I think it's probably better for the environment in terms of increasing ridership. I think it would reduce noise for residents who live along the rail corridor in town. So, but I very much am aware there's another path that is push hard to get more rail service, and there's a big chunk of the town that that's what they want. And I believe the last time we had a rail meeting on this, it split pretty much 50-50. So anyway, I would support it, want to see details in the MOU, would like to have, make sure that that's good and strong.
Loss for our cultural, our history in Atherton. And I think Malcolm brings that perspective to us because of the length of time.
center loading stations where you had to cross the tracks to get from one, go to one direction to another, which are very dangerous stations. Because if you, and they're called holdout stations because if there's a train in that station, the other train can't come through it because it's too dangerous. They have to stop. And because of that situation, when Caltrain made the commitment and spent the money to electrify, they knew that to have a holdout station would seriously interrupt their electrified service, and they would have to change that station from a center loading to a station that would load on each of every other side. And that it, and as costs have gone up, that change in a station is an extremely expensive cost, which Caltrain has estimated at $30 million. Now, there's $25 or $30 million, I think, is not relevant. I think what's relevant is there's a very significant capital cost, which has forced Caltrain to look at whether it makes economic sense to Caltrain, and both from a capital budget perspective and from an operating perspective, to maintain this Atherton station, which was at one point heavily used, but we all know, and especially over the last 15 years, when it's only had weekend service, has not at all been heavily used. I have had the honor of serving with Kerry for the last 6 months on the subcommittee that met with Caltrain at their request to explore the level of service that would be provided to Atherton. And that didn't start with Caltrain telling us they wanted to shut down the station. It started with Caltrain publishing a 2040 projected report for the business plan for Caltrain to 2040, and when it identified the level of service in every station along the line, and for Atherton and I think one or two other stations, it had TBD, and we said, well, TBD. We'd always been promised it would become weekday service once we were electrified, so we started a conversation with them. And the information that has come out tonight, I mean, we've had 13 residents comment under public comment that you'd like to see the station closed, and we've had one comment that he'd like to see the station left open. And I know that the opinion within our community is more evenly balanced than 13-1. This station is an asset of Atherton. It has been something that has been here for more than 160 years. And it's something that has been heavily used in the past. But it's not heavily used today. And I think that the right way for us as a council and representing all of you to look at this is, what are the trade-offs? What is it that we get if, in fact, we, it's their decision, it's not our decision, but what is it that we get if they, in fact, decide to sell, trade off the state, close the station? And for me, the number one issue is safety. It has to be, how do we improve safety? And number two, and it's close, is quality of life. How do we improve safety and quality of life? Because, like several people stated, we don't know what's going to happen in the future. All that we know is that there's going to be change. And I think that if we can, we've had one suicide on our tracks, and I feel lucky that we haven't had more. But one is one too many. And if we can protect against that, and we can in particular protect what I consider a very hazardous crossing of Watkins, that it will benefit all of us because it will make it safer and it will improve the quality of our lives. There's no issue that I've been involved with in the 7 years I've been on this council where I got more positive feedback about things that we did as a council to change people's quality of life than when we established the quiet zone at Fair Oaks Lane. And Caltrain will not be involved in establishing a quiet zone here. We don't, with the Caltrain, will be involved in making a decision about what to do about this station and what the trade-offs are, and they've proposed seeking an investment of about $8 million to make this happen, and I'd love to see that, you know, I'd love to see anything that can happen. happen on that track that will improve the safety and enhance the use of that property for Atherton residents. I think the fence that they propose is extremely attractive. We see that at some other stations. I think that's the right kind of thing for us. I mean, if this is going to close down, absolutely the platform has to be removed. It has to be made as safe as it possibly can. I think I agree with some of the comments about the specific letter and, for example, with respect to the issue of the installation of quad gates. It says safety features at Watkins, potentially including quad gates. I think that, and staff has said they believe that to be a commitment. There hasn't been an engineering study yet. I think they make an engineer. They have to have an engineering study before they can make a firm commitment. But we are going to enter into a memorandum of understanding, and that memorandum of understanding will develop these agreements, including the reference to the lease agreement about our being able to use that property as part of, well, whatever we want, but it will be part of the town center. So I think in some ways it's a very sad change because we're losing an asset, but progress often has sad changes, and this is, I think, a progressive change that at the end of the day will benefit Atherton residents. And I also want to say, our relationship as a town with Caltrain has been very complex. I mean, we were involved in creating the organization, helping it get its first funding. It wouldn't have happened with Malcolm Dudley not running up and down this peninsula to talk to every city council, because he was voted down 6-1 when it was first considered and ended up getting a majority of the city councils to support Measure A, which is what funded Caltrain. So, and then with high-speed rail coming down and the threats of how high-speed rail would divide our community, there ended up to be a very contentious relationship with Caltrain. And I just am proud that we have gotten back on a cooperative footing. And Kerry Wiest has had a huge deal to do with that. But I think this is an important public agency in our community, and it's here to stay. It's not going away. And I think it's important that we partner with them and work together.
Look at that. Seems fairly clear that the council supports the basic tenets of the council's proposal. Would you like us to move forward then with the next steps of working with the subcommittee to help make it better and more unit to the terms of council that goes down and develops in the future?
Yes, I got that indication.
That's outside of the $7 to $9 million. It's a the idea is to work together to look for grant opportunities. Do that. We can certainly talk to them about what we'll men share and where that might come from.
I don't think they can make these commitments because it's not their property. You know, it's their and I don't think everyone.
We'll move this through quickly, sir. All right, Mr. Mayor, as Vice Mayor and members of the City Council, really appreciate Chief McCauley inviting me here to talk to you a little bit about the use of ALPR technology and kind of what we do in the Northern California Regional Intelligence Center. We're a regional asset throughout Northern California, bringing together technology, resources, assisting law enforcement with expanded tools to help them do their job more effectively, more efficiently. And the big thing that we do for our region is that we bring together ALPR policy, we bring together privacy impact assessments, we also bring audit controls, as well as cyber and physical security for the data. Our role is really to bring together the federal, state, and local law enforcement within Northern California, and to bring those strengths, address deficiencies that we have throughout the region. We have hundreds of law enforcement agencies throughout Northern California that we connect to each other, so that way they can identify those individuals that are criminal actors that operate throughout the Bay Area and throughout Northern California, and sometimes throughout the entire country. Now, the two primary uses for ALPR technology, that instant feedback, which is the alerts for stolen vehicles, alerts for license plates that are stolen, amber and silver alerts for those folks that we're trying to find, along with wanted persons and subjects under investigation. The other use case scenario is investigative use. And that's for if you have a crime or similar crimes that are occurring throughout the Bay Area or the region, we can use that to help us identify the suspects and the vehicles that are used for those vehicles. Also, it allows us to search incomplete plates where witnesses only get partial plates. It helps us to identify those vehicles just based on partial plates. The things that we see when people use this are decreases in reportable crimes, including burglaries. We also see an increase in those folks that are driving around stolen vehicles. Most of the time, we'd often find the vehicle abandoned, broken, burnt up, damaged. Now we're able to catch the crooks in the cars. The other piece that we work on is that proper utilization, data collaboration, allowing agencies across multiple jurisdictions to be able to use this creatively to identify those criminal trends and those criminal actors. So someone that's committing crimes in San Francisco or in Oakland or Piedmont, wherever they are in our region, we're able to use this technology to help us to track those criminals and what they're doing. And to go back, and we retain information for 12 months in our area, allows them and allows those investigators to have 12 months to use the data. We only give the data to law enforcement personnel for a lawful purpose who have a need and right to know. We do not give data to the public. And what is included in that is dispatchers, analysts, and those folks that are working criminal investigations. Again, everything that we do is audited, logged. We track who's in the system, what they're searching. And then when you look across the country, there are varying areas where they store the data. We purge it after 12 months. If it is connected, if the vehicle is connected to criminal activity, we have the authority to store it for 5 years. And we base all of that on, all of our systems are based on California Attorney General guidelines for data retention, storage, and that's where we've settled all of our systems to a 12-month period. We also, after Senate Bill 34, which emphasized transparency, required these types of presentations, education material for folks to understand who has access to the system, how it's used, who has the authority, and what are the rules. dissemination of information. The goal of what we have to do is also training our personnel and law enforcement how to appropriately use the system, how to protect our systems from any breach. And then there are responsibilities that come out of this for if there is a breach, you know, how do we communicate that to the affected personnel? A lot of what we do as far as the coordination and the effort is an education piece. So all the material that we're providing is online. So if anyone has anything that they'd like to look at later, just look up NCRIC.org or ALPR, NCRIC ALPR, and it should pop up for you on any Google search. And the other piece is for the protection of special events. That's something that we also use ALPR technology for. We do have a list of known or suspected terrorists for those under investigation. If someone that is a vehicle associated with them on that list comes by an ALPR, that creates an alert to let them know and at least have law enforcement give them a little heads up before something shows up on their doorstep, especially when they're trying to protect an event. We also have had instances where we have individuals that are actually under threat by terrorist groups here in the Bay Area, not too far from here, where we've had individuals that we've had to deploy technology to make sure that they're safe as well. As far as success stories, we've had a number of them, even local ones here. Within San Mateo County, we've had some where, in fact, we had one where we had an individual that did a strong arm robbery at one of our local shopping centers. You know, took the woman's purse, threw her to the ground, drove away. They had a license plate. The license plate came out back to registered in the Central Valley. They ran the ALPR, and in seconds, it showed that that vehicle had been parked around the same location for 6 months. And that location was in Redwood City. Officers went to that location, and when they arrived, the vehicle that was stolen the purse with the bad guys were all right there with the purse. Got that back. That would not have happened without the use of this technology. We had a number of shootings in San Jose years back. ALPR technology helped us identify the person that was shooting at vehicles over a several-month period. We also had a bank robbery where we only had a partial plate with only three letters. We were able to run that plate, identify the vehicle in the North Bay, and the FBI was able to knock on that door, and the person actually confessed to all the robberies. We had another case in Daly City where we had a 12-year-old girl that a man tried to snatch off the street. She fought that person back, and he ran away. That one was a lot of work because they had to actually go through images to try to match the vehicle description and the license plate, but they were able to do that. They ran that license plate information, it came back to a registered sex offender, and that registered sex offender was arrested that day. Wouldn't have happened if that ALPR information was not available to those officers. If you have any questions, and I'm here to answer any that you have, but we also have one of the technology vendors here as well to talk about the specific technology that the city is looking at, the police department is looking at. So I can pass that off to them, and I'll be around for any questions you have.
Thanks, Mike. So my name is Davis Lukens. I represent Flock Safety. I'm the head of product development. There we're based in hardware and software company based in Atlanta. I appreciate the time. I'll try to be quick. Those are some great case studies, so you can see the effectiveness of the technology. So I'll focus mainly on how our technology is different and how it's been able to kind of change where and how we can deploy, both from a private and a public perspective. While he's getting going, just a little background. We started by selling our LPR product to neighborhoods. Our CEO actually had his own neighborhood, had a theft in it. Talked to the Atlanta Police Department. They gave him a suggestion of buying a $50,000 ALPR for his neighborhood. He was like, he went to Georgia Tech. We can build one that is much, much more effective and much more cost effective for neighborhoods. Then we ended up with a town in Texas, about the same size as Atherton, about 65 to 7,000 residents. They came and were like, can we buy 30? Sure, we can buy 30. And they ended up with a situation of getting about 8 to 10 hot list arrests a week. They also believed to be one of themselves to be one of the most safe places in all of Texas. and even they are seeing 8 to 10 arrests a week off of this product. Let me jump. Go. Keep it moving. Jersey City, Jersey Village, Texas. So we also focus a lot on the combination of private and public, a little different take on the LPR. So both private and public can buy our product. Everybody who buys the product, they own the data. It is not in any way owned by Flock. We do not have the rights to sell any of it and never access it for any means other than in the case of being able to help a private under their guidance and with their written consent, we can help them to provide data to the police. But this was a case just north of Atlanta where the combination of private and public LPR resulted in catching over 10,000 pieces of stolen mail that had happened over the last month and caught a ring of about 5 to 10 people who had are now in jail as a result of the combination. Our LPR covers about 400 million cars per month across about 36 states, about 400 cities. This is the example of Jersey Village. They created kind of what they call a virtual gate by using the hot tag alerts, which are the more proactive, notifying the police in their car or in dispatch. They know when someone comes into their city. They also can use that data in order to do the retroactive detective type work. Where our product kind of differs from the more traditional is we go for an infrastructure-free model. That means that included in our price, which is $2,000 per camera per year, we provide all that is necessary to deploy it, including solar and LTE coverage, as well as all of the 30-day storage that we host in the cloud, all which is secure under what is the CJIS compliance in order to hold any CJIS data. That would be your NCIC or California SVS lists, which are those that hold the hot lists, so stolen vehicles, warrants. So we follow all required guidelines in order to have access to that and have done that under overall California goal, including working with NCRIC. But you can see we can deploy both on existing poles, powered, as well as on speed trailers, which is supposed to be extremely efficient and effective at deploying extremely quickly, as well as in certain situations such as special events. We did a study against a fellow competitor in the LPR market in LA. LA Sheriff's Department uses our technology. They have about 100 deployed in that area. We were catching about 1.3 times the amount of reads that they do. And we do that through a very unique way of doing LPR. A traditional LPR uses infrared technology to reflect light off of a license plate and reflect it back into the lens of the camera to capture the data. We take still full color images, which lets us use machine learning to actually read the plate itself, allowing us to capture more cars, including ones with temporary plates, no plates. We can also do state detection as a result of it, since we have a color image, so we know and have a lot less incorrect hits, because a traditional LPR does not distinguish between a New Jersey and North Carolina or a California plate. And so someone that is, you know, on the NCIC or hot list in New York would hit on a plate here and you'd get false alerts to the police. And finally, it allows us to do things even that are covered plates, which is happening more and more as LPR becomes a big thing. People are putting these reflective IR blockers on. In the essence of time, we'll go through a demo, but we, from just an overall case study, our biggest case study, this is the one of the biggest counties in Georgia. It also contains the most crime-ridden beat in all of Georgia, this is what it looks like. So they went out and covered that beat with about 10 to 15 cameras. The result was a 64% reduction in entering autos over the period of time in which the Flock ALPR was installed, and an overall 35% reduction in entering autos across the whole entire precinct in which that particular beat is, including also a reduction in 40% in robberies. And during that period of time, the only change had been the introduction of LPR from Flock.
What type of time frame?
It was a 9-month time frame.
Can you explain entering autos? What exactly does that mean?
Pretty much, you could probably describe it better.
Your knowledge, it was being breaking into a vehicle.
Okay.
Yeah, just, and so, again, the other thing that we can help provide is our price of $2,000 per year allows a lot of both HOAs as well as the police, along with hotels, apartment complexes, to buy into the camera. Again, everybody owning their own data, but then it starts to create a network in which those more private owners can provide access to the camera to the police under the same platform in the case of a crime in their particular area.
So, out of curiosity, you mentioned Jersey City installation of 30 cameras, which obviously was a very dangerous place with all the things that were going on. What was the transition to now the safest city? How long?
Oh, so they believed themselves to be the safest city before they even installed them. So they expected that they would just put them in, it would help continue to improve, help them continue to be the safest city, and they continue to get. They realized they would get 8 to 10 a week,
so some complaints.
Yes,
exactly. But, just to be clear, though, that struck me too. That doesn't necessarily mean the residents of Jersey Village are any safer.
Right.
You're getting hits on plates of people traveling through, presumably, either through the Mexican border or what.
Yes.
But you're getting through, so that may not necessarily affect the public safety for the folks in Jersey Village, right?
The positioning of Jersey Village is not one that would result in people kind of driving through it in order to get to another major city. It's kind of off to the side. So these would be people coming into their community that would be on a national or local level.
I'm sorry, I don't want to go to the statistically, that would work. If you got 7,000 people down, it's getting 10 additional arrests per week due to this technology. That's going to so dramatically change its crime rate that it can no longer be anywhere near a safe city in Texas, much less a safest city in Texas.
So these are hits, not specifically alerts. So those are two different things. These are people coming in. It may be someone that is considered a sex offender or something like that additionally. Those would not be arrests that you would make. So sorry if that was...
I got you. Yeah, that's how I think you said 8 arrests. I think that's what
you said. We see 8 to 10 arrests on our overall platform. 8 and then, I'm sorry, those numbers kind of mirror each other.
Problem with moving cameras will go in or out to be changed. So we have the first
Yes, they do.
Does the city manager have access to that house?
Well, my wife's concerned because I'm watching her now. She leaves the house every day to go to the mall. I don't know.
And kind of a related side here, how are you handling that? What are, in your view, the primary protections we're putting in place to make sure that the information is treated carefully? And not
well, I think maybe Mike can comment on that.
Definitely. As far as the information itself, so in this scenario with Lock, the data would be sent over to our offices. We would have the data retention for the agency. We're having the same conversation with some communities that are buying these cameras that say, hey, it's, you know, if you have these cameras and you're a private owner, you only know what's coming in, what's going out, and if you want to share that with law enforcement, you can. But we have the capability that working with some of these larger housing projects that if they want to actually give law enforcement real-time information, so that way they can respond to whatever it may be. Now, ultimately, the officers and the dispatchers have to run the plate, confirm that it's wanted, stolen, or part of an investigation visually. So that alert will come up and they'll have a picture of it. Now, that doesn't mean that an officer can run these things just because he feels like it. They have to have a lawful purpose for running the system. That's audited, logged. We have training for folks on how to use the system. There are rules as far as retention. And then the other part is...
What is the retention for us? I don't know. It's 1 year. Okay.
And then based on the request from the chief of police, we can provide them with audit logs and audit information every year. And what we do is we verify and vet that the plates have happened. And we will do random audits throughout the year ourselves. And we'll actually ask officers, where's the report that goes to this search?
Is it a criminal offense to potentially abuse the process?
It is. So as part of this whole CJIS process, that our criminal justice information system, sorry about acronyms, but as part of this criminal justice information systems, any use of the system, from our side, we kick them out of the system. From the chief of police side, that's an internal affairs investigation if there's a violation with potential prosecution, firing, termination, or suspension, or whatever they deem appropriate.
And with the FLOC system, it also has the protections built in, just like make who access to what people are using. And as an addition to our policy, our recommendation from council, that we had the audit function for our policy, which is what we have before you tonight. And it said outside entity, I don't know what that means yet. If you're in that group within the hours, or nobody will see if you can add that layer of security.
Mr. LeBron did that.
I see no general public comment. What I think I'd like to do is bring it back and deal with the other.
Very briefly, to the chair, I had a question. I believe it has been answered. Is that when the camera detects a positive in the hot number database, is that the officer just says, well, I got a hit, and then the officer has your code dispatched to actually find out why the number is in the database? And that's how we get the question.
Thank you, Rob. Okay, so let's bring it back that we're really dealing with the policy in the request to approve the policy that's been modified.
Yep.
Is there any specific presentation with respect to the policy we all have in front of us?
No, other than minor modifications, again, primarily dealing with the audit component.
Yep.
We added some language from the Center for the County Sheriff's Office on the issue of hits. This is a way to make sure that we're not stopping some of the human stuff with the department to do the wrong protection, and that's about the number of things that are involved.
There was a question regarding the request to ALPR data by non-law enforcement. There was a sentence on page 2, and then there's a reference to a civil code section regarding records maintenance and police policy. So I typed up some suggested language could address it so that it's a little more clear, it doesn't necessarily reference non-law enforcement or non-law enforcement.
I know that's the question you're making.
So I brought this up before, and I still have the same question. That's kind of a nebulous description. And I agree all the documentation before does have the protections in there. And I do appreciate that you put it in the audit function, as several of us asked. But this one here kind of is like an open door. And it's not clear as to who can ask and who can't get passed. And so I would request that we either list for our approval what non-law enforcement agencies we are willing to give it, or we don't allow this to happen and have another mechanism
for something to generate. The issue that you're questioning, I believe, is who can ask, in my understanding, anyone has the right to ask. That, but what it says is that we cannot comply with what we do public disclosure request for information that cannot be disclosed.
That's a civil code.
So the response was to just remove that language.
Yeah.
Not by non-law enforcement and non-prosecutorial agencies.
I don't see any need for that.
So the sentence is still there, it just removes those two.
Just removes that.
Yeah.
I did have a comment regarding the audit, which I also think is really important. I understand the tension between not wanting to be available to the public, but wanting a legitimate audit out there, an independent audit, obviously, an independent audit. We got a sentence here that says the information is not open to public review. And we're going to have an independent audit, so the audit will therefore be a law enforcement related. What entities will be able to do the audit? We can't have public review on it. Would be able to. It can't be a member of the public, it could be a law firm, it could be a citizen body, it could be anything like that. Right?
No, it's more likely that would be another law enforcement agency that access. Yes.
Do you have a suggestion? I'd love to see a strong audit.
Yeah, and we have a privacy officer that's one of his. Part of his full-time job is pulling those audit records and going to the agencies and asking them for the additional information on not only the audit log that we have, but what is the backup material in the law enforcement report, investigative report, the CAD records, or whatever information they have to verify that search was done for a lawful purpose. So that's kind of what we do for our regional partners.
And what percentage wise do you catch bad actors?
You know, we have every request that we've made thus far over the last number of years that we've been doing this, we have always found backup, we've always found the information, so we have yet to find one where it's being abused. basically, I thought, you know, even me, I thought we'd find somebody that would have a, you know, not be able to bring a report forward or not have backup material, but we've been able to find backup documentation. And these are totally random. We search agencies randomly across the region, and those that are requesting those reports or their own internal audits, we have yet to find one that they didn't have material to back it up.
There's also a question, too, that if the information was back, you say that they did information about the place, and et cetera. I did some research with NCIC, that's administered by the FBI, and by California law enforcement, telecommunications system, their systems are in the groups. Have there been misuses? Yes, internally by an operator, and those are found in a criminal violation, and prosecuted and confirmed. The systems themselves.
How do we as council members be able to check in?
My office.
Let me
add a couple of comments.
different numbers in, or different ranges, and if I didn't have that identified, then it was still being remaining as it was on the original document that we looked at a couple months ago. I also came up with, for a discussion starter, a way that having this and sending the document out to the people is one way
building's completed or is finished, at which point we've got our finance line up, we're all done, they've got something specific to look at. We might be able to go to people and say, you know, what we'd like to do is something additional, whatever. I don't know. I just don't understand. We're sort of off time. Our timing is off here.
Yeah.
We're coming down the COP path. We got to figure out a number that we're plugging in a number for that and starting that process tonight, I guess. So I don't understand how this is going to link up. I'd love to hear that.
Okay. So can I
yeah.
respond? And I really appreciate that thinking. And,
yeah.
you know, because of the question, you know, why do we need the money? I don't think it's necessarily why we need the money. I think it brings people to have, they will feel more of a bond and ownership of a person. And it will help us retire that debt, you know. Or maybe if we get we should know that. If it's March, I don't know how realistic it is. But maybe we can't get a purchase of those three going to be else by March. We've been trying for years and haven't done
it. So I just want to say that I want to reiterate that we originally have stayed on course related to the donor wall and that we weren't doing flags all over the place. Now it seems like we want to change the course of that. I'm not really thinking that we have to change the course of that at this point. I mean, if in fact
back what we said we were going to do, which was a committee report.
And what bathroom, it's already covered.
I think the direction is that we'll contact people that have made donations, and if they want to name something after them, they can take the affirmative action to let us know. And if there's new donations that are going to be at the level of that we identify for a naming opportunity, that we'll put some kind of identification. Yeah, some kind of recognition.
But it's that first part, contacting the donors.
having to clean it up, it